I'd like to begin by expressing thanks to Sigmund Lowland for thinking of me as a speaker for this plenary session, and to the organizing committee of the ECSS for inviting me to this outstanding conference in this unique venue and in this wonderful city. So, 1 year before the opening ceremony, the International Olympic Committee, the IOC, had identified 28 interest groups that had announced plans to use the Beijing Olympics to highlight political issues during the next year. The Save Darfur coalition linked the Olympic Games to the genocide in Sudan. On human rights issues, the most active organizations were Amnesty International and Human Rights Watch. On press freedom issues, Reporters Without Borders and the Committee for the Protection of Journalists. Riots erupted in the Chinese province of Tibet in March 2008, and shortly thereafter, the Secretary General of Reporters Without Borders disrupted the Olympic torchlighting ceremony in ancient Olympia by unfurling a banner depicting handcuffs in place of the five Olympic rings. With the support of the Central Tibetan Administration, located in India, the International Tibet Support Network organized protests during the International Torch Relay, which merged with other protests to create chaos in London, Paris, and San Francisco. It was easy to be misled by the heat of the media coverage into believing that profound political conflicts were occurring. However, closer examination reveals that there was no serious momentum toward national boycotts of the Olympic Games. More national Olympic committees, 204, and national representatives, of which 100 were national dignitaries and about 85 were heads of state, took part in the opening ceremony than in any previous games. It was the first opening ceremony attended by an American president outside of the U.S. It has been estimated that in Beijing, some 30,000 corporate leaders from around the world were hosted by the corporate hospitality programs, and that some 400,000 local government officials from China were hosted. If some terrible terrorist act had destroyed the city of Beijing during the opening ceremony, the world system might have come to a halt. In fact, on many levels, the Beijing Olympic Games signified a new level of global unity rather than disunity. But in comparison with past controversial Olympic Games, such as the boycotted Moscow 1980 Games and the Los Angeles 1984 Games, something had changed. What had changed was that the political debates were not coming directly from individual countries, but from international interest groups taking advantage of the huge media platform. The IOC had learned from government-led boycotts that it should stay out of politics, but the kind of politics it encountered in Beijing was entirely new. The IOC had commissioned a detailed risk assessment and had prepared for political crises in the lead up to Beijing. But there was no crisis with North Korea. There was no crisis in China-Taiwan relations. There was no crisis in China-US relations. All this didn't happen. The IOC would have been prepared to deal with government-led boycotts, would have been prepared, but it was not ready for the debates raised by non-governmental organizations, or NGOs. I'll be using that abbreviation, NGOs. Its main defense was to say, we are not a political organization. In this, it was repeating arguments that it had perfected during the Cold War. But now, the organizations leading the attack were not political organizations. They weren't national governments. They were non-governmental interest groups. From their inception in 1896 through the end of the Cold War, I would argue that the primary function of the modern Olympics in global society was as a vehicle of diplomacy between nations that were, frequently hostile toward each other. The end of the Cold War has decreased the emphasis on conventional interstate diplomacy, and it has increased the emphasis on public diplomacy. This means that the IOC is no longer just mediating between governments, but is mediating between a complex array of actors. It includes the government of the host city, multiple national governments, the United Nations, non-governmental organizations, and the international media. The Beijing Olympics in 2008 took place amidst this period of transition, not just for the IOC, but a transitional period for the world order. Also, the fact that the Olympics took place in China, which is seen as a rising superpower on the verge of challenging the supremacy of the US and of Western culture and civilization, this strengthened the sense of a changing political balance. This was the broader context for the Beijing Olympic Games. So, can the Olympic Games contribute to a better world? You're probably thinking that my question is hopelessly broad and can't possibly be answered. But today, I hope to look at this question from a perspective that's a little different from the usual one, and to approach it from a concrete angle that offers some preliminary concrete answers. My perspective is that of a social scientist and a China scholar. And today's presentation is largely based on empirical research on the organization of the Beijing Olympic Games starting in 2001. So, as Professor Lowland indicated, I'm a cultural anthropologist. I've been working in China for 27 years. I lived in China for a year before the Beijing Games. I did ethnographic fieldwork on the Games. Since then, I've returned multiple times to China. I had the opportunity to do extensive interviews with Chinese government officials, members of BOCOG. BOCOG is the Beijing Olympic Organizing Committee. Journalists, human rights groups, United Nations representatives, different members of the IOC and staff, and also everyday Chinese people. And after the Games, I also conducted more than 30 hours of interviews with Hein Verbruggen, who was the chairman of the IOC's coordination commission for the Beijing Olympic Games. And in that capacity, he was the liaison between the IOC and China. Thanks to his support and to the support of IOC President Raga, I was granted access to the relevant documents and communications. And in 2010, I also had the opportunity to work with the coordinating bureau of the World Expo in Shanghai. So I was fortunate to become one of the few people who worked on both of China's historical mega events. And in my capacities as a member of the academic experts teams, I was the only non-Chinese member. So the Beijing Olympic Games were unique in the public debate that they stimulated about the capacity of the Olympic Games to contribute to a better world. And I will use the actual debates that occurred as the primary framework for my discussion. And today I'd just like to run through three kinds of perspectives. I'm going to start with the perspective of corporate social responsibility. Then I'll look at the question of cross-cultural dialogue and international relations in the context of the Olympics. And finally, I'll conclude with a humanistic perspective that considers the power of the Olympic idea. So, corporate social responsibility is reflected in the notion of Olympic legacy, which has become increasingly important since the end of the Cold War has shifted the emphasis in the Olympic Games. During the Cold War, it had seemed a good enough contribution to a better world when the Olympic Games had brought together hostile nations on the same playing fields. After the end of the Cold War, in accord with global democratic trends, there has been increasingly strong criticism that Olympics should not be the tool of governments and political elites, but should serve the people. The Albertville 1992 Winter Games were the first in history considered to have universal participation and no boycotts. And as it happened in 1992, the Barcelona Summer Games provided a rather successful example of the use of the Olympic Games in urban regeneration. So legacy in the form of urban renewal became one of the claimed positive impacts of the Games, a claim that, of course, has also been made for the upcoming London Games. At the same time, corporate social responsibility is increasingly becoming a way of assessing and managing the social impact of organizations. The IOC is not a corporation, but more and more it is being treated like a corporation by non-governmental organizations that are pressuring it to engage in the kinds of practices that characterize corporate social responsibility. Why the IOC is being treated like a corporation when it is not one is itself an interesting question. My preliminary answer is that corporate social responsibility is a rapidly growing field. It has developed a set of concrete procedures and standards that are globally recognized. Advocacy groups have been rather successful in using this concept to push corporations towards change. And there's a near global consensus now around the importance of social responsibility, which was marked in 2010 when the International Standards Organization, or ISO, launched a set of voluntary guidelines for environmentally and socially sustainable activities. But I think we should note that this consensus is not perfect, that the production of the guidelines by the ISO was contested, and in particular by China. But the point is that corporate social responsibility is a growing movement in today's world. So a larger context for the Olympic Games is that they are in this transitional period in which they are adjusting to a new world order that demands new levels of public accountability. Almost as soon as the Cold War ended, environmental issues replaced boycotts as the major threat to the hosting of the Games. As early as 1972, Denver had rescinded the hosting rights to the Winter Games. In 1994, Vancouver had withdrawn its bid for the Winter Games. Nagoya had encountered strong anti-Olympic movements. The influential environmental group Greenpeace first turned its attention to the Olympics in 1992. Leading up to the Sydney Olympics in 2000, Greenpeace organized a high-profile campaign against Coca-Cola and the Sydney Organizing Committee. In response, in 1999, the IOC, in cooperation with the United Nations Environmental Program, developed Agenda 21, the IOC's program for environmental sustainability. And the IOC named the environment as the third pillar of the Olympic movement, along with sport and culture and education. And so in the 1990s, we saw the end of the boycott era and the beginning of the NGO era, the era of non-governmental organizations, in which the Games would increasingly be targeted by these organizations using the huge media platform to raise public awareness and to use the pressure of public opinion to forward their own agendas. And this was also part of a world transition. During the 1990s, the number of NGOs in the world increased from about 6,000 to about 26,000. And they gained a greater influence in the United Nations and in international relations. The success of the environmental NGOs in the Olympic movement became a model for other NGOs, in particular human rights NGOs, looking for the IOC to incorporate human rights into the bid process as it had incorporated environmental issues into the bid process. Here is a chart I developed trying to summarize some of the social responsibility issues raised in the context of the Games, together with a list of the elements of the Olympic system and the United Nations system that are involved in them, as well as the NGOs that are actively working in the context of the Olympic Games. Since corporate social responsibility is supposed to include concrete procedures and guidelines. So I looked at which social issues are actually handled in the Olympic Charter, the candidature manual of the IOC, and the candidature files of the host country. These three sets of documents constitute the documents that are considered legally binding in the organization of an Olympic Games. And if you look at these documents, you find that actually very few of the key social issues are treated in those documents, with the exception of environmental issues. There are also several major procedures that are not treated in the documents, although they are customary. Just for example, since 1988, the IOC has worked with the World Health Organization to have tobacco-free Olympic Games, but that's not actually verbally required in writing in these documents. Or the organizing committee must be certified by the ISO, the International Standards Organization, for its environmental management practices. An interesting on the question of the death penalty, which was big on the agenda of Human Rights Watch, the IOC does have a customary practice to request countries not to use stadiums for death penalty executions. And they did request that China would not do this, and it does appear that China honored that request. But all of this is not in writing. It's sort of verbally negotiated customary practice. Another point that's evident from this chart is that different agencies of the UN system have become increasingly involved in the Olympic Games in recent years, particularly since 2001, coordinated by the UN Office of Sport for Development and Peace. It was active more than ever before in Beijing, with 17 agencies carrying out programs and 10 representatives in attendance at the opening ceremonies. Something that I have noticed also in a recent visit to Rio de Janeiro is that urban planning, of course, should be an important part of Olympic planning, because legacy and urban renewal has become so important for Olympic Games. But there's really a big disconnect between the IOC, which knows how to organize a mega event but is not really an expert on urban planning, and then urban planners who know how to do city planning, but they don't really know how to utilize a mega event to maximum effect to achieve urban planning benefits. This isn't such a problem in a city like London, which has so much experience hosting big events and Olympic Games anyway, but in a city like Beijing or Rio de Janeiro, which doesn't have any experience with Olympic Games, they really struggle with how to use Olympic Games to do good urban planning, and that's probably one reason that empty stadiums often result at the end of Olympic Games. So, I think, though, it's important to understand that even with all of this involvement of the United Nations system and NGOs and some mention in the host city contract, there actually is limited legal backing for many, if not most, of these measures. And I would like to just comment about the issue of human rights in China. Leading up to Beijing, Amnesty International and Human Rights Watch accused China of breaking a promise to improve human rights that was made during its bid for the Games. And this criticism was widely picked up by journalists and other NGOs. But after the Games ended, several books have been published in Chinese which have discussed the internal debate that was occurred in the bid committee surrounding human rights and whether or not to even mention the word in the bid presentation before the IOC session. So based on that, we know that the bid committee wasn't even allowed to mention the word human rights until the 48 hours before the presentation in Moscow. It was such a sensitive topic. And it's clear that they had no intention of promising or making a legally binding commitment to improve human rights in China. In asserting that the IOC had authority over the Chinese government, these organizations focused on the host city contract. But there were no clauses regarding human rights in the host city contract, certainly none specific to China. The host city contract is the same for all of the candidate cities, and it's simply presented to whichever city wins the bid. Its main purpose is to fix financial obligations. There are other documents that are considered an integral part of the host city contract, the bid presentation and the candidature file. But if you look at that, you would find beyond the one sentence about human rights in Moscow, the word is never mentioned in the bid report, the candidature file of Beijing. So really the only legal issue that received a lot of attention from the IOC was intellectual property protection. And anyway, it probably could not have taken to court the organizing committee for a violation of its promise to improve human rights in China, because the signatories to the contract are the Beijing Municipal Government, the Chinese Olympic Committee, and the organizing committee, BOCOG. So the central government, which is responsible for human rights, is not even a signatory to the host city contract. If the IOC had wanted to try to sue for a breach of this promise, it would have the case would have been heard in the Court of Arbitration for Sport. This is required by the host city contract. But the CAS is a private arbitrational body. It's not a court of law. Its decisions are only binding on governments that agree to be bound by those decisions. And this is a unique characteristic of sport law. It's not based on treaties between sovereign states, but agreements between bodies that are independent from their national governments. So that is agreements between the IOC, in this case BOCOG, the organizing committee, the national Olympic committees, and the international sport federations. These are all non-governmental organizations. So the Olympic system is autonomous from national governments. It's a transnational regime that's very unusual in legal terms. It has to rely on voluntary compliance by governments and organizations. This is what has been called soft power, the power of attraction, as opposed to hard power. And anyway, after the IOC has allocated the games to a city, it's in a very weak negotiating position. Sometimes critics argue that the IOC should threaten to revoke the games from a host, but this is really not realistic because the size of the games makes it impossible to shift to another location on short notice. The IOC has never sued any host city over a breach of the host city contract. And in recent decades, probably all of them have violated it to a greater or lesser degree. So the IOC is operating in a supranational no man's land where very few governance mechanisms exist. But so, in part because we have nothing better, the corporate social responsibility model is rapidly moving into the world of sport. Sport Accord, which some of you might have previously known as GACE, the General Association of International Sport Federations, is now moving in this direction. It's urging international federations to engage in social responsibility reporting. They have a reporting framework that was launched in 2011. Human Rights Watch continues to pressure the IOC to establish human rights standards for bid cities. And in their model, there would be benchmarks that a city would have to meet from the moment the bid was successfully won until the organization of the games. They presented a paper in Copenhagen and most recently at another United Nations meeting. And so, because the IOC is being treated like a corporation or a government, it is reacting like one. It's claiming environmentalism to improve its image. This is known as greenwashing in environmental circles. It's using philanthropy and humanitarian aid, culture and education to respond to some of these issues. But ultimately, in my opinion, the corporate social responsibility model for the Olympic Games has its limits. These are just technical issues in organization, and they're tangential to what I consider to be the IOC's major function in international society, which is to facilitate cross-cultural dialogue and international friendship. So the strength of the bid process is that it offers an open field for communication and dialogue, not that it forces countries and cities to comply with a legal code. So I would like to say something about the status of cross-cultural dialogue surrounding the Beijing Olympic Games. There was a huge fascination among the Western public with the question of whether the Beijing Olympic Games would improve human rights in China. But in my opinion, this reflected a naivete about the absence of genuine dialogue between Western and Chinese publics. The Olympics, it was not possible for the Olympics to have a great impact on human rights in China when the dialogue and the furor were going on outside China and not inside China. In 1 month before the Beijing Olympic Games, there were about 5,000 reports in Western language media, the major European languages, on human rights and the Beijing Olympics. In the same time period inside China, in Chinese media, there were about 20 reports because of the censorship of the topic of human rights in China. So the furor about China's human rights largely consisted of Westerners talking to each other about a problem in China, and this is not dialogue. So despite all of the rhetoric about how the Olympics increase mutual understanding, I don't think that a lot of effort has actually been devoted to the question of how to promote genuine cross-cultural understanding through meaningful dialogue. We congratulate ourselves on the fact that the Beijing Olympics reached an unprecedented global audience of approximately 70% of the world's population, but we know very well how superficial most of that coverage was. I mean, very little of Olympic broadcasting or media coverage constitutes a dialogue in any real sense. The IOC claims that it doesn't have responsibility for facilitating dialogue on sensitive subjects because it's a non-political organization. And I'm actually somewhat sympathetic to this position. But it's not realistic to believe that you can simply bring large numbers of sports people together under a code of silence that prohibits political expressions inside Olympic venues, and that this will lead to productive dialogue. Nor do marketing campaigns or publicity campaigns in the mass media constitute productive dialogue. Since the IOC doesn't take on the responsibility for public dialogue, it means that nobody's responsible for it. There's no single entity charged with improving public, dialogue. So it's left to the culture and education programs that surround the Olympic Games. And these are not always meant to facilitate dialogue, but rather to educate and entertain. There were a huge number of academic conferences in the years leading up to the Beijing Games, but these were not covered in the mass media, so they had a limited public reach. So, in short, there's really not any entity devoted to organizing dialogue on the political issues associated with the Olympics. In my opinion, the major function of the Olympic Games in our new global society is to enhance our sense that we are all members of a single human global community. And maybe the sense of a shared humanity is the first step towards reaching consensus on actions on global issues that we are facing more and more: environmental degradation, the global financial crisis, and so forth. The Olympic Games bring together more heads of state, more CEOs, celebrities, opinion leaders than any other event. Can we make better use of this? I mean, can they do more while they are in the Olympic city than just party and celebrate? Could they possibly engage in meaningful dialogue? And I think that we academics have a responsibility to offer new ideas about how to fulfill the potential of the Olympics as a vehicle for international understanding and problem solving. So I would just like to finish with the notion of the power of an idea. As we know, Pierre de Coubertin, the reviver of the modern Olympic Games, believed in education. And he had a great quote that the future of civilization does not rest now on political or economic foundations. It depends on the educational orientation that will be put into place. The IOC does have a big network of educational organs and associated bodies, but it does not really mobilize them in a concerted way in the context of the games. They occupy, they operate rather independently. So I would just like to note that I do think that the Olympic idea has a certain power, and that the whole furor that we saw around the games was a result of this. The games contribute to a sense of global unity, as well as heated public debate, the world as we wish it to be, the world as it really is, Gemeinschaft and Gesellschaft, and so forth. And human beings need hope, and the Olympic Games do provide a message of hope. And this is something that groups like Amnesty International have to ride on, because they exhaust their audiences with their depressing messages, and they know that they can only conduct campaigns every few years, otherwise their audiences give up and get depressed. So the Olympic Games offer them a platform for their activities. So I think the Olympic Games can contribute a little bit of inspiration and utopian dreaming, and that this is important, and we need to correctly recognize its social function. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Susan, for a reflective talk on the possibilities of the Olympic ideals. We have about 10 minutes for comments, questions to the speakers. Anyone? You have one? As good chairpersons, we always prepare the first question. So, Pavel, you have a question?
I have a question, maybe not a good one. The answer will be good, I'm sure. Lars, most of the big international federations have their own sports medicine or medical committees. How much interaction is there really between the IOC committees and those big ones in the individual federations?
Can I please ask you to stay for the last 10 minutes? It's really disturbing for the audience and for us when people are walking around all the time. Please.
So the question was actually, since the international federations are responsible for their different sports, do they have a sufficient medical service? And the answer is that, well, there are about 35, 36 of them involved in the Olympic movement. There are other, of course, sports without being in the Olympics. Many of the big ones have pretty good, medical service built out. I would say it varies quite a bit. So Great Britain, England, US, and New Zealand, Australia, Scandinavian countries, quite good. But there are other areas where they really don't have anything. Africa, South America, on the average, I would say, is very little built out. And the question is also, what is the communication between the IOC and those international federations? And the answer there is variable. We work very closely with, for example, the International Skiing Federation, on creating new rules, new venues, new equipment, and so forth. Much of the funding is coming from the IOC. We work with FIFA on football. We work with all the major, I would say, international federations pretty closely. We meet once a year in a meeting, three-day meeting, where they tell us what they're doing, and we criticize them and ask them to improve. I would say that it is now getting much better than it used to be. When I started out, it wasn't so good, but it has really changed. And the potential, if we are going to change something as the IOC, we have to do that through National Olympic Committees and not the least international federations.
Thank you. Susan, what would be the biggest obstacle towards your dialogue ideal? Would it be correct to say, like some say, that actually those increasing the level of aggression in the Olympic discourse would be the mass media? The logic of the mass media is confrontation, personal confrontation, national confrontation, organizational confrontation. Would it, in your analysis, be correct to say that if we look at the biggest obstacles, this might be the one? And this would also relate to your experiences from China, from the Beijing Games.
I do think there's a problem in that the mass media are not designed as a vehicle for genuine dialogue. That's not what they do. They specialize in sound bites, and they are oriented towards specific national audiences in most cases. So you would really want to look elsewhere for a platform that would facilitate dialogue. And I don't think the IOC can be expected to do that because, from a philosophical viewpoint, it's reluctant to engage in what it calls political discussions. But, you know, organizationally, that's probably not what it should be doing. So who should be facilitating Olympic dialogue? I think it's left to us, the academics. And so I feel that we academics have a responsibility to think about how this huge mega event, which has such an important place in today's global society, can be used to be put to better use with a more positive social impact. We don't have much unity as academics who study Olympic studies. There's no society for Olympic studies. We don't seriously get together to discuss political action, perhaps, like we should. So I think other people can do it, but we academics have our responsibility as well.
Thank you.
I would go further with Lars about the collaboration. ECSS is a powerful organization, as you know, and you said very well. Thank you. What would be the major expectations from your side to us as a college and as a members of the scientific community?
Yeah, this is something that we actually have debated a little bit inside the IOC. We have something called a medical commission, which consists of now about 12 academic people from around the world in various functions, from me as a surgeon to people like yourself. My original thought when I started with the IOC was to change the system of medical commission to include worldwide academic institutions such as, for example, it could be ECSS or ACSM or similar organizations, that they would have a place on that table, which I think would be a good idea. And this is something that we are debating. The current president, Arne Ljungqvist, is not for it. He wants to be totally unpolitical, as he says. But this is an ongoing work, and there are many organizations that are really pushing. For example, FIMS is really pushing hard. They are not a very strong organization at the moment, and probably will not be a member, but they could potentially be one if they had a good system. There are many other academic organizations that are really, I would say, on a daily basis almost pushing for this. And I think that my hope is that, you know, the IOC, one good thing about working in the IOC, let me just take that, because I'm used to working in a hospital in Norway, and, you know, I've been chief there for a long time. All my work there has been trying to save money. been very strict budgets and so forth. The IOC has a lot of resources. And by working there, I have noticed that if I can think some good thoughts and I want to achieve something, I can actually do it. And that's something that can that the IOC can do because of all the resources. And one area that I'm working very hard in trying to accomplish something is the area of funding research. I think that the IOC has responsibilities, not only in my field, sports medicine, but also in sports science and other areas. And the IOC should take that responsibility by having funding systems. And I think that within, you know, relatively short time, we have a system right now, but it's not really fully blown out. We will have this. And we will have a new president. Unfortunately, Roger is retiring. We will have a new one, so nothing much is going to happen until he or she gets there. It's probably going to be a he, unfortunately. But within a couple of years, we should have a system in place where we will play a role in that area as well.
Yes?
I would just like to observe that we've really seen from Dr. Ingebrigtsen all of the initiatives that are taking place in the area of biomedicine, and it would be entirely possible for the IOC to have similar mechanisms with issues related to social impact. But there are no consensus meetings on key issues, key social issues. You know, the amount of funding for research on social or political implications of the games is much less than the multiple projects going on. So, I mean, I think the IOC is certain, and Dr. Ingebrigtsen are really to be commended for the expanded effort in the area of biomedicine. But it could completely be used as a model for dealing with social and cultural issues in the Olympic Games as well, if the willpower were there.
and my comment to that, I really agree with that one. And my comment is that I think that that push has to come from the academicians themselves or yourself. You have to propose ways to do it. Now we see how we've done it inside medicine, and sports science. But clearly this can be done in other areas as well. It's just a matter of taking initiatives and propose and push and have your politicians help out with that.
That, I think, is an optimistic message of possibility at the end of this session. We are looking forward to great possibilities when it comes to research funding in the future and Olympic studies in the future. And I wish to thank our two excellent speakers.